Hello, welcome to the final video in the Python classes series, where in this video, we are going to be going over property decorators and data classes. So let's just jump into it. All right, so we're back to the Pokemon class here. And the only thing I've really changed outside of maybe deleting some stuff is I've added in this type 2. So we now have type 1 and type 2 types for a Pokemon. Now, the reason I've done this is because we're going to be referencing something called move types. So move types in Pokemon are typically moves that a Pokemon can do based off of their types. So let's go ahead and create a function that can return the types that the Pokemon has. So we can do def move types and then self, and it can return an f string of self.type1 and then comma self.type2. Oops. Great. So now if we go ahead and print bulb.moveTypes, we can see that we will get grass and none, because we have grass as the type 1 and none as type 2. So far, so good. But this is okay. But what if we want to be able to maybe calculate something or do something else based off of this? Well, we can still do that with a function. But what if we want to be able to set the move types, right? Type 1 and type 2, ideally at the same time. Well, we can kind of do that by just having two lines, right? We can do type 1 equals fire, oops, and then bulb.type2 equals poison, right? We probably don't want it to be fire. We probably want it to be grass, right? And then we can go ahead and run this, and now it's updated. But it would be a lot nicer if we could just do bulb.moveTypes equals grass and poison, right? Because now we can actually just do it all in one line. But there's actually a couple of issues with this. If we run this, we get an error, but not the one you might think. The error we actually end up getting is that it's saying string is not a callable function. Basically that this doesn't work. But that's because even though we have this function called moveTypes, we have reassigned this function to a string. We've basically just made the property of moveTypes, which was a function, into just a string. So then when we try and call it, it's saying, I can't do that because it's just a string. So one way around this is we can actually make it so that we always ensure that moveTypes is a property. So we can say at property. Now, if we make it a property, we actually can't call it as a function anymore because it's considered a property. So we can do this. And if we comment this line out, I can go ahead and show you that if we run this, we can get grass and none because it's calling this as a property. Again, not as a function. Even though the underlying implementation of this property is a function, so it can kind of do whatever a function could do, you're just calling it as though it is a normal property on a class. Pretty cool. But if we do this, we're going to see that, well, it's going to be a little bit confusing. So if we run this, we're going to get an error again saying that, well, we can't set this because there's no setter. So, okay, maybe we can just make a setter, right? So we can do def move types self value string and then do self.type1 and self.type2 equals value string dot split comma, right? Now, if we do this and we run this, it's going to look like it works, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's not working. So the reason that it's not working, and just to kind of prove this, let me go ahead and call this here. So print like setting Pokemon types to, let me make this an F string. I don't know why F strings aren't just default. Self.type1 and self.type2. So if we do this, we would expect that when we set the move types here, that we would see this. But if we go ahead and run this, we can see we don't see that. But not only do we not see that, if we go ahead and also print out bulb.type2, where it should now be poison based off of this, we can see it's actually none. And what's happening is, because we now have a property of move types, right, which we saw that we could just call like this. And then we've defined another function called move types. We're now setting on this line right here, we are now setting this move types function to be grass and poison, which then overrides this property that we have here, which means that this kind of is irrelevant and this is now just this string. Really weird, right? It's a very easy thing to get wrong because it kind of seems like it's working properly. But what we should do now in order for all of this to work is simply to add at moveset or movetypes dot setter. And as soon as we do this, when we run our code again, everything works properly. Now, the reason that it's working properly now is because we have defined our property here, which is what we're referencing at the very end here, right? We can print like, hi. And if we go ahead and run this, we can see that it's printing out hi because that's where it's referencing this grass and poison from. I'm going to get rid of that. And then we can also see that we're doing this setting Pokemon types to grass and poison, because when we call this setter here, we are calling this this function with the string, which is whatever's after this, to effectively set the type 1 and type 2 based off of this function here. And we're going to go ahead and print it out as well. And then we print out the type 2. We don't need the type 2 anymore. So that's pretty cool, because now not only do we have a property, kind of like name or type 1 or HP or whatever, that is actually a function, so it can be like generated whenever you call it, right? And it can use the context of your class. So it's a very super powerful thing. Now you might think like, but isn't that just the exact same thing as like just a function? And kind of, but because you can reference it as a property, you can set it as a property. Now, that's not to say that you couldn't achieve all of this with like multiple functions, right? We need multiple functions to do this anyways. So if you removed this and then like made this like move types setter, right? You could do this. You could have the exact same thing here where now you're just saying like setter is this and this, right? We're effectively getting the exact same result here. But the issue is this, that was way less clean than just doing this, right? If we have this is like, you know, from the developer's perspective or somebody who's getting to use this, move types is just another property. They don't care. If you don't care what it's changing in the underlying, you know, class itself, then a property is awesome because you can just treat it as a property. But as you, the developer who's implementing the class, you can make it do whatever you want within the setter or in this case, the deleter, which is another thing you can actually add to classes for these properties, where you can do def move types self and do self.type1 equals none, self.type2 equals none, and then we'll just print like deleted types. There we go. And then we can do an at move types.deleter. And what happens here is now let me copy this down here and we do del, which I'm not sure if we've talked about before, but is a keyword within Python where you can delete a property from a class or an object. You can just do del bulb.moveTypes. And that will then call this function here. So if we go ahead and run this, we can now see we have deleted types. And finally, when we print out move types again, which still exists because it is just this function, it's just a property, but the values that we're actually returning, those things have actually been altered when we've gone ahead and deleted it. They're now none. So that's amazing. We can now do anything we would have normally done with, you know, multiple methods or functions that you would need to make sure you call correctly just with a single property. I think this is really cool. It's something that is not necessarily super unique to Python, but it's a really useful thing to be able to know how to use. Hopefully that makes sense. Now, before the end of the video, I also promised to go over data classes. So let's do that real quick. All right, in order to start with data classes, we're gonna do from data classes, import data class. Now, data class is another decorator that you can add to a class. So let's do at data class and then do class person. Now, the really cool thing about a data class is that it's basically a class that is just meant to hold data. You can add additional functionality to it yourself if you'd like to, but it kind of handles all of the kind of annoying stuff that you might have to do to implement the class. So it handles the init, it handles the string, probably a bunch of other stuff, but those are the ones that I'm at least familiar with. So let's go ahead and create our data class for person here. We can do name, str. So this means that you're defining what a property will be and what the type of the property will be. So what is it expecting? Then you can do age, int, and then let's do salary again and do int. And then you can also specify a default. So now if we go ahead and do print person, Jake 32, we can go ahead and see that when we run this, we get person name equals age, Jake, name equals age. I don't know. I can't read. Name equals Jake, age equals 32, and salary equals 10,000 because it used the default 10,000. And you'll also notice I didn't have to specify like name equals, right? I could, but I didn't have to. So this is just a really simple way of making sure that I have an object that is holding some form of data and I don't have to set up anything else, right? This is like five lines of code and like very short lines of code, but it's already created this object that I can then pass around and use as much as I need to. Now, I think this is one example of maybe why classes might be a great kind of use case. If some people aren't super fond of classes or the idea of using classes. So in my experience, a lot of times, maybe you don't need to use a class, but if there's ever times when you need to pass objects or pass data, that's not just like an integer or a string or something like that, but it's a bit more complex, right? It's multiple pieces of data that need to be passed together. Maybe it's an XY coordinate and a name or, I don't know, a URL with some parameters or something like that. Creating a simple little data class like this is amazing because you can create it in just a few lines of code, but then you can package all of that data you care about into this single object that then you can return. And the reason that's so powerful is because if you then need to later on add a new thing to your class, you can do it with one line of code. And then wherever you're creating your class, you just add one more line of code, or maybe not even if it can have a default value. And then that class or that object is then being passed around your program already. So it's a super powerful thing. I hope you give classes a shot because they can be really, really helpful when programming. So that's it. That's all for this video. I hope you have enjoyed learning about classes with me through this class series. If you haven't checked out the other videos, I'll leave a link to them in the description below. And consider subscribing to the channel. I've started streaming a bit. I haven't streamed this week, but I'm going to try streaming more and more often because it's a lot of fun. In my past streams, I've been creating an app using Flutter with the Dart programming language, which I had never touched before the first stream. So I've made a lot of progress on that, some of it off stream because it was just so fun that I love to do it anyways. I hope you stick around and watch some of the other things and join the community as well. We have an awesome Discord with some really cool people. So that's all for this video. Remember, I'm Jake. You're awesome. This has been Python, Class Properties, and Data Classes. Cheers.